If you notice from yesterday, we are going with lots. There is no senator who is more important than the other. Proceed, witness.
Thank you, Honorable Speaker. I may not have captured the exact names of the Honorable Senators, but I will deal with the questions as they were asked. So the first question was to do with when did the other companies get back their documents and the dates the companies got their documents. I'm not sure of the exact date when these documents were returned, but procedurally, we only focus mainly on the company that we are investigating either for procurement irregularities or certain issues. Like, for example, in this particular case, Shobika was the special company that we were looking at, and that was the reason why that particular one was identified, because the bid document actually had challenges, as I had indicated in my evidence in chief. Then we come to Honorable Mungatana, issues of gifts and the cows. Now, as I had indicated, gifts that are of value of more than 20,000 shillings are supposed to be handed in and are declared by all public officers, including state officers. For this specific matter, we have not investigated as to the existence of the material, cows that are in this particular issue. But if indeed cows have been donated to any public officer, those donations are supposed to be donated to the state. And the officer within 48 hours is supposed to hand over that donation to the institution that employs him. So that is my take on that. Then we had the issue of extension of time for the bond, bid bond. Now, as I had indicated previously, the closing date for this particular tender was supposed to be on 23rd February. Bid bonds are supposed to be attached, or they're supposed to be part of the bid document, the tender document. In this particular case, the bid bond was hand delivered to the CEO in her office when the bond, the tender documents were already inserted in the respective tender boxes. So for that reason, extension had to be found in order to have that document be part of the tender document of that particular company, which is Shobika. So that led to the extension, and that was instigated by the permanent secretary, who did a letter, which is in our documents, directing the CEO of KEMSA to extend the date of closure of the tender from 23rd February to 10th March. Now, that is the issue which the date of extension to be extended, the date of closure to be extended. Now, let me come to investigations by various bodies created by the Constitution. Now, investigations will either be in terms of course, each institution has its own mandate as far as the Constitution or the legislation or the statute that created it is concerned. Now, when it comes to criminal investigation, and specifically issues to do with leadership and integrity, issues to do with corruption, that responsibility lies with the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission. Now, other institutions, other constitutional bodies can do their own investigation, but they will, if, for example, they are recommending for criminal charges, those recommendations have to be made to the respective institution that is mandated to charge people or to investigate criminal cases, like the DCI or the ESCC. So it depends on the mandate of the institution and what is the focus of that particular investigation. But for example, if it is the PPDA, the Public Procurement and Disposal Authority, they do not have powers to charge people in court, or rather to recommend to the DPP to have people charged in court. What do? They have to do a recommendation to either the DCI or to the ESCC to investigate the criminality of that particular issue. So I just want to indicate that it depends on the institution and the mandate of that institution. But when it comes to criminal investigations, there are specific institutions that are mandated to conduct criminal investigations. Issues to do with the declaration of gifts, I think that one I addressed in my earlier submission, that gifts that are more than 20,000 are declarable and they have to be entered in the registers. And after end of every financial year, the institution has to actually declare to the ESCC of the existence of that gift. Now, the issue of what was our finding or our conclusion when you look at the whole matter and our perception, or rather, what would be our conclusion that we reached. Now, when you look at this particular tender, first, it is an international tender that was floated as an open tender to international companies. Companies bidded, but there is a specific company that has a local agent here, which is Shobika, that did not conform to certain procurement requirements as per the tender document. Because when tenders are floated, that tender has got specific instructions or directions to the people who are bidding. If, for example, you are supposed to do pagination, it has to be indicated there. If you have to do, for example, in ink, it has to be there. So anything that goes outside what was provided for in the tender document is actually considered as irregular. And of course, the disqualification should apply. So this one, it was a tender that was badly handled, and I wouldn't want to indicate why it was handled that way, but from the look of it, there must have been some pressure somewhere. That is my own view as an investigator, because when you see procurement officers deliberately going out of the requirements, because they know the law, there are only two conclusions that you can make. One, they were bribed. Two, there was an influence that was coming from other quarters. Mainly those are the two reasons from our experience. So that is my conclusion. I wouldn't want to delve into the conclusion of Dr. Mulwa, because he gave evidence before this House, Honorable House, and his evidence is there. Now, the issue of Terry Ramadan and her status. I think ours was, and whether we actually received feedback. As seen in our documents, we did a letter to the, on Terry Ramadan, let me refer to the documents. We did to the chairman, the chairperson of the board of directors of KEMSA. And we gave him the reasons why we think, or it was our view, that action should be taken, disciplinary action should be taken against this particular officer. As to why she's still in the public service, I wouldn't want to go there, because our responsibility, when it comes to administrative action, we tell the institution to take the disciplinary action.
Order, Senator Newton.
We do not have the powers
Senator
to compel
Fernandez, take your seat.
For example, the PS, sorry.
Proceed, Abdi.
Thank you.
Mr. Abdi.
So we do not have the powers to compel the chairperson of, we don't have the compellence powers as far as administrative action is concerned. So I want to leave that for the honorable members to decide what to do with that. So I move on. Then the issue of reading of the donor community and what our view is. You know, if you may allow me, Honorable Speaker and the members, the medical, or rather the health sector, has faced serious challenges of corruption throughout this period. Throughout the period that I remember working at the ESCC, it is an area where a lot of donors are actually almost giving up in supporting our programs. And that has a serious repercussion. Because first, let's understand.
Mheshimiwa Speaker, in the past, with tremendous respect with all the other witnesses, you have been indicating how much time they have to respond. 5 minutes, 10 minutes. And my good friend here, the witness, you did not indicate how much time this honorable house is giving him to respond.
Thank you so much, Senior Counsel. That was courtesy of my good friend, Senator Seki. Now, witness, ordinarily we've been given 10 minutes to respond to clarifications sought and questions. So far, you have done 4 minutes and 13 seconds. You have 5 minutes and 47 seconds to conclude.
Okay. Thank you, Honorable Speaker. So that one I've dealt with. So the issue was that was also raised is, which report do we stand by? As ESCC, we did an investigation and we submitted our report, the findings of the report to this committee, I mean to this Honorable House, and that is the report we will always stand by and defend. The other issue that was raised was whether we had any case that we have investigated against the DPP and whether we have proposed charges or anything like that. That is, we have not investigated the Deputy President, His Excellency Rigathi Gachagua. We have not investigated him for any criminal matter in the past. That is our position. Now, there was also the National Assembly hearing. Why we did not attend the National Assembly hearing and now we are attending the Senate. We were not invited to the first hearing. Yesterday, I was served with a summons of this House, and we are simply responding to that summons. As to why we were not invited in the other one, that I don't know. And we only responded to the summons that were issued. So then, Senator Omugeni, the companies associated with the DP, we've not investigated any company that is associated with the Deputy President so far, and that is our position. Then, Honorable Senator for Kakamega County, activities that are intricate web of suspected to be corruption. On all the items, Honorable Senator, that you have told us whether we have investigated, I think there are five. We have not, because a report has not been made to us, and we should not only wait for a report. I mean, we also have the powers to investigate on our own motion, but it is only after we analyze the reports as to whether they fit in within our mandate. Like, for example, if you deal with issues of inheritance, unless there's a criminal aspect on the inheritance bit, inheritance usually will be handled as a civil matter. And issues to do with intimidation, if the CEO of KEMSA had reported to us that he was actually intimidated by a state officer, we would go into it. Of course, you understand, all of us understand how difficult it would be to open an investigation of that, you know, that magnitude. But no complaint has been made to us. On the Gen Z uprising, also, we have no report. We know it happened, but as to the corruption bit of it, we do not have facts.
2 minutes to go.
Okay, thank you. So, gifts, I think I talked about them very clearly. Issues to do with whether we want to charge, we want to press charges against companies associated with the DP. We have not investigated. We can only recommend charges after investigation to the Director of Public Prosecution. That is our mandate. And the other one, of course, is intimidation by the CEO of KEMSA. I think I had addressed that one. Then finally, is whether we want to prefer more charges or more sanctions against the persons involved and on this matter, especially on criminal culpability. That the issue of criminal culpability is still open, and we will be inviting some people probably in the near future. But as of now, we dealt with the issues of administrative action against the individuals involved. Thank you, Honorable Speaker. If I may have not addressed one or two questions, it's
very well. Now we move to the second round. Senator Omtata.
Honorable Speaker, was there any clarification for us to respond to some questions that have been put to us?
Just listen to this lot so that you
can. Sugar is running a bit low. There are many questions.
It's running low to everybody.
Okay. All right.
Mr. Speaker, sir, to the witness from the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission, I would like to ask whether the Kenya Kwanza Coalition document is unconstitutional and therefore null and void to the extent that its formula for sharing executive power violates Articles 10, 27, 129, 130, and 131 of the Constitution. Number two, if that's the case, who is to blame for approving the unconstitutional coalition agreement that resulted in forming a government? Number three, can you point this Senate to any hard evidence of criminal conduct which you have unearthed in your investigations against the Deputy President? And can you distinguish whether there's a circumstance where the Deputy President, or even me as a senator, can walk into a place and be given a gift that I don't have to declare, irrespective of the amount of the gift? Because I engage officially and privately. So is there a situation whereby I can be given a gift of whatever magnitude that I don't have to declare? Thank you.
Senator Chuta.
Thank you very much, Honorable Speaker. Honorable Speaker, let me first of all thank Bwana Abdi for many years' service he has given to this country, and we highly respect him. I want to refer Abdi to ground number 11 and also to his documents, page 7. Ground number 11 says, His Excellency Rigathi Gachagua bullied Kenya Medical Supplies Agency officials into awarding a tender for supply of mosquito nets to Crystal Limited. And in your letter, on page 7. The commission, let me read. The commission is of the opinion that the conduct of the CEO, Terry Ramadhani, amounts to violations of leadership and integrity act, particularly section 10 and 11. Mr. Abdi, today as we speak, Terry Ramadhani is a deputy ambassador in India. And Mr. Mutuse, Honorable Mutuse, wants this house to get rid of the deputy president on the account of being bullying somebody. Can you tell Kenyans, 50 million Kenyans today, as you stand there, do you want this house to impeach the president if you have already recommended some culprits to be given administrative, what do you call, action, and then you want us to impeach the president?
Senator Kamau Githuku.